you here tonight, and to see you on the TV. So you really don't need much introduction. But let me just tell our people again, Matt Murton, who is part of our congregation, obviously, and his family. Matt also plays for the Hanshin Tigers. If you're visiting Japan, you don't have no idea who the Hanshin Tigers are. A baseball team here in Japan. Matt's from the imports, plays from the US, but plays for the Tigers team. And Matt's going to come and share something with us this morning. Come on up, Matt. Let's go.
I have to practice, and I'm taught that if I don't practice, if I don't do A, B, and C, then I can't succeed. See, and that's something that God has been really working on me, not only when it comes to playing ball, but also with my wife, Stephanie. You know, obviously, you want to provide, you want to protect, you want to do all these things. You want to be in control of that environment. You want to be in control of your children and making sure that they're in a good environment when they go to school. You know, you always worry. Stephanie and I were up, you know, the evening before the kids were going off to their first day, and we were just praying about how we need to allow ourselves to just let go of these children. They're his children. Allow them to go to school, because you worry about how are they going to fit in with their classmates, or, you know, how is it that they're going to, are they going to listen to their teachers appropriately? And I always tell Steph, I said, you know, we have a five-year-old little boy. I said, it takes some time for them to understand what that structure is. And a lot of times, you know, unfortunately, they can do some things that will get themselves in trouble. But we're always looking for control, whether it's with our significant other, or our children, or at work, or even when it comes to what we're going to have coming in the future. I think as foreigners, I know for us, you know, coming here to Japan, I think a lot of us when we get here, maybe we're on we're going to go to Japan, so we're being called to go, but how long we're going to be here, we don't know. You know, God knows, but we don't know. And I think a lot of times we want that sense of control. Steph and I will sit up at night and talk about how, I wonder what's going to happen next year. I wonder what's going to happen, you know, the year after that. We would all love that five-page summary of what it is our life is going to be, not only tomorrow, but the following year and the year after that. But that's what we're called to live by faith. And so many times, if we can just live at that address and just occupy today, we'll be much better off. So I'm not discounting the idea of hard work, not at all, because like I said, I get up there and practice and practice and practice. But what I am starting to learn that the Lord's working on me is there is an element of training, but there's also an element of trusting. And I've been reading this book, just finished, it was given to me by a friend of mine, and the name of the book is called Overachieving. This is, biblical author, his name is John Elliott. He's a PhD. He's a professor at Rice University. And I was reading his book, and I got a laundry list of things here that he talks about, kind of your training mindset or your control mindset versus your trusting mindset. And I just picked three of these out just for the sake of time. One, the training mindset is always very judgmental. The trusting mindset is always very accepting. The training mindset wants it right now. The trusting mindset is patient. The training mindset wants control. The trusting mindset lets it happen. So for me, every night when I go to the ballpark and I get in the box and I step in that box, I've done all the training. All the training is finished. There's nothing left to do when it comes to my practice. At that moment, the best thing I can do for myself is just trust in the ability that God has given me. Look out there, see the pitcher, and try to see the ball. See, a lot of times I think, you know, I'll get up to the plate and I'll say, okay, I've got to get my hands here, and I've got to put my foot here, and if I can do all these things, then I can be successful. The more I do that, the less my mind and my eyes have the ability to really focus on what it is it needs to focus on. See, when I truly trust and I get in that box and I'm really hitting well, there's nothing being thought about except for that ball coming down the home plate and me taking that swing. It doesn't matter if it's a big situation. It doesn't matter if there's nobody on base. All that matters is I see that ball. That's my focal point. Keep it very simple. And if I can do that, then I can hit. The moment I start trying to control it, the moment I start trying to say, I'm going to do A, B, and C, I'm never near as successful. So for me, that parallels into my spiritual life. See, one of the things I want to go back to just briefly is when I was speaking about practicing, okay? Christ says in Proverbs 16:9, he's talking about, let me get the scripture so I don't butcher it. It's not that hard. When you're speaking, I always have a tendency to mess it up. He says in 16:9, we can make our plans, but the Lord determines our steps. So again, that doesn't mean that we can't practice. That doesn't mean that we can't work on things, because we should plan. We should, you know, look towards the future. Yet we have to realize that there's a balance there, because at the end of the day, we have to remove that control for Christ. I think I love this story. I was just talking to a friend recently, maybe the past couple of weeks. And I think the story helps kind of illustrate for me how it is that we're supposed to let go, how it is that we're supposed to let go of the control. And one of those ways for me, and I was speaking to him specifically on this verse, is found in John chapter 4. And in John chapter 4, we're all very familiar with this story. It's the story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman. During this time period, Jesus was leaving Judea, and he was moving to Galilee. And along the way, he was passing through Samaria. And when he arrived in Samaria, he was speaking to the woman at the well. It was Jacob's well, but he was speaking to the woman at the well. And we all know the synopsis of this story, which is that Christ basically revealed to her things that she no more could have believed he knew other than the fact that you are the Messiah. And after that moment, she went back to her village and she was telling everybody about oh, the Messiah's here. He told me all these things that there's no way he would have known if it wasn't for the fact that he has to be the Messiah. And so here comes this large crowd. Well, here's the part that I want to kind of pinpoint. During that time period, they were traveling, and I'm just kind of, Pastor Mauricio, you'll have to forgive me because, you know, I'm not a biblical scholar, so if I mess it up. But they're traveling during this time period, and, you know, he had been sitting down with the woman at the well, and here comes this large gathering of people back to see the Lord. And his disciples were with him at that moment, and they were speaking to him about eating. Lord, you need to eat. And I'm assuming that they wanted to eat for strength, you know. And if you look in John 4, again, verse 34, but starting here in 32, he says, I have a kind of food that you know nothing about. He says, and then the disciples say, did someone bring him food while we were gone? They have no idea how is it that he is not eating food at this time. And he says in verse 34, and this is what I was talking to my buddy about. He says, my nourishment comes from doing the will of God who sent me and from finishing his work. So for me, if the Lord, in regards to his Father, says that his nourishment, all he needs is just to do the will of the Father, that's enough for him, then I sure as believe that it should be enough for each and every one of us. And so we were talking about it, that I think so many times, my buddy and I were on the phone, and we were saying so many times in life, spiritually as well, we feel like to be the perfect Christian, we have to do A, B, and C, and then the Lord will be happy with us. And really, what he's asking of us, and this is something that I keep trying to remind myself, all he's asking for is for us to serve him daily. And to remind ourselves every single day that we are to live looking towards the will of the Father. So John 15, you know, when we talk about doing the will of the Father and having the nourishment of Christ just by doing his will, John 15, and this is something that Pastor Bruce has been speaking on over the course of this series on growth. I want to focus on John 15, 5, which says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. See, here recently, that second portion of that verse, for apart from me, you can do nothing, is something that I've really been focused on. Because and in fact, I've written it. At the ballpark, I have a leg guard that I wear. And for whatever reason, don't ask me why, I wear this leg guard. So I always hit the ball above the leg guard, right on my leg. I got to learn how to make sure I hit that leg guard. But anyway, on the leg guard, I wrote the verse, John 15, 5. And the reason I wrote it there, I wrote it on my hat, I wrote it on my backs. And the reason I did was because that's kind of the thing that God's been working on with me right now. And that is this. Apart from me, you can do nothing. See, a lot of times we get in there and you're performing well and you start to think, oh, I'm doing this and I'm doing that and all this stuff. But in reality, you're only doing it because God's allowing you to do it. And so, when we look at that, apart from me, you can do nothing. I keep trying to focus on that. All he is saying in this is that he calls us to remain in him as he remains in the Father. And he's telling us that a branch cannot produce fruit if it's severed from the vine. Now, I was reading this book, this guy, a pastor and an author back in the United States, his name is Tony Evans. And I was reading this a few years ago, and I really like the illustration I'm going to share today. And that illustration is this. So many times, I believe, we act as if we are laptops. What do you mean by laptop? What I mean by laptop is this. I think so many times in life, we come to church on Sunday, or maybe we read our scripture in the morning or whatever it is, and I'm guilty of this. I know I'm guilty of this. And we plug into the power source. We're connected to the mind. And then what do? Then we unplug from the power source as a laptop, and we walk around like we're sufficient in and of ourselves with the power that He's given us, and we don't stay connected. And then we go back, we plug back in, and we get some more Jesus, and then we unplug, and we move about our day. See, God doesn't want us to be a laptop. God wants us to be a PC, the home computer. He wants us to stay plugged into that power source at all times. And that's something that He's been challenging me. He said, now, if we can stay plugged into that power source, if we can stay plugged in the way that we're supposed to, now in verse 8 He says, you will be able to produce much fruit. And if you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. And if you are my true disciples, you will bring great glory to my Father. So, that's free. To me, that's free. I no longer need that sense of control if I can truly live at that address that each and every day I'm just going to occupy today. And each and every day, all I'm going to do is just try to be plugged in. See, we can't do it ourselves. I know I can't do it myself. When I'm up there playing ball, or whether it's the family, or whatever it is, I know that in the end of myself, and sometimes I want to believe I can. And then God smacked me real quick, and He said, no, you're going to either do this my way, or, you know, you're not going to do this at all. And He smacks me, and He says, you know what? He says, if you stay plugged into me, I'll take care of the rest. To me, that's free. I can start to take away some of that control if I just let it happen. And He went to the cross for us, and we all know this. And for those of us who may not understand the entire gospel of the story, we wear these bands, and I got to get some of these, and I got to bring them to church and allow everybody to get one. I should have had a good day, but on the band, I have 1 John 3:16, and we all are very familiar with that verse that says that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. He died and He went to the cross. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for somebody else. And to think that He went to the cross, and when I remind myself of that each day, that how He hung on that cross and He did it for me, and He did it for each and every one of us in this room, and all He's asking, all He wants is for us to just abide in Him. I think that's a very simple task when it really comes down to it. The same way that when I'm at home plate and I'm looking at the picture and I start getting it all muddled because I got to do A, B, and C, it's harder for me to focus on D. It's harder for me to get to the result of D. When I can simply do this, see that ball, relax, trust my ability, and get it, I can be much more successful. When we're in life, I feel like if we stand there and say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to focus on you. I'm going to focus on the eternal prize that I have before me. I'm going to keep it simple. Each and every day, I'm going to try to live for you. And I know I jack it up. But when I can do that, the rest of this stuff takes care of itself. So in closing here, the last few things, and again, today, one of the things I really just wanted to do is just share what God's really been pressing on my heart, is that so many of us are given certain spiritual gifts. And I think a lot of times we try to be all things. And in reality, I think God blesses each and every one of us with our own personal spiritual gifts. He has equipped each and every one of us for a moment and a season in our life. And all He's asking us to do isn't to be everything. He's just asking us to live for Him right now. And if that means for whatever it is that we're doing here, for me right now, that means going to the ballpark, just allowing others to know that I love the Lord and welcome. That's what He wants. If it's for Stephanie, you know, to be a mother to the children and to develop a relationship here in Japan, and that's what He has for her right now, that's what He wants. So for each and every one of us, He has something for us, and He has a plan. Now all He's asking us to do is just stay plugged in. I think a lot of times I get guilty, and I was talking to my buddy about this, and I said, man, I'm not doing enough. I'm not doing this, I'm doing it. And I think that's a good thing, because sometimes we need to stand up and act, and that's the time we'd be comfortable sitting. But I think that with that being said, there's a moment to just slow down and just say, you know what, Lord, here's my life. You have me here right now. And all I'm going to do is just try to allow you to work through me. And only by that way that you work through me in the power of your Spirit now I can produce fruit. So I want to encourage each and every one of us. We are a body of believers, and we have brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's how God operates. He uses each and every one of us, whether it's maybe out there playing the ballpark or whatever it is that any of us are doing while we're here in Japan. He's using each and every one of us to complete his purpose. So in closing, when I get up to that plate, I shared this last year. I get up to that plate, and up there on the facade there in right field, some of you may remember this, there's these four initials up there. And it doesn't matter what the circumstance is. It doesn't. It doesn't matter if the bases are loaded or whatever, the place is going crazy. I get up there and I stand at that plate after I draw my cross. I draw my cross first. And I'm like, Lord, I can't do this without you. I get in there. That doesn't mean I can hit every time, by the way. I get in there, and I look up, and I say, and there's these four initials up on that facade, and it says T-O-T-K. I have no idea what it means. It's some advertisement. I don't know, but I made it something for myself. I always try to pick out stuff from the ballpark. And the first T, by the way, is circle. And to me, those initials for me have become trust our true King. And that T, circle, big circle. So I get in that box, and I swear I get in that box sometimes. I'm staring up at this facade in a big moment. I bet all the people in the stands are looking at me like, what is wrong with this guy's name? Here he is, this corner. He's staring up in the stands. Doesn't he know he's supposed to focus on the pitcher? Well, hold on one second. Before I focus on the pitcher, I got to focus on who it is that allows me to be in that box. What it is, how I need to keep it simple, how I need to look down there to see that ball and hit it, how I need to trust him. So every day I try to remind myself to trust our true King. And like I said, it doesn't mean we're always going to get hit. It doesn't mean that in life things are always going to go our way. But what it means is that we have a Savior who's taken care of it for us. And we're to trust in that fact. So what I would encourage each and every one of us today to do is this. The man who went to the cross for us, all he's asking us to do is trust. He's asking us to trust in his plan. He's asking us to trust when it comes to our family. He's asking us to trust when it comes to, obviously, our children. He's asking us to trust when it comes to our job. He's asking us to trust when it comes to our future. And all he wants us to do is to stay plugged in. And if we can stay plugged in, then he's going to produce fruit. Because if we remain in the vine, then he's going to take care of the rest. So my prayer is that we'll just stay there. And for anybody who may not understand what that is, I pray that the same way that I gather my confidence and my strength in the fact that I have a Savior who's taking care of, I pray that one day you will understand that fact. And that one day you too will trust in the Father in heaven. Because he has completed it all. The work is finished. All the practice has been done. All you have to do is accept who he is. Thank you for the opportunity to share. God bless you.
Please stand and have a couple more worship songs. Sing our praises.